Jeez, it's rolling. Hello, Betsy. How are you today?
Joe, I'm fine. How are you?
Great, thank you. May I have your full name and, if you wish, your birth date, please?
My name is Betsy Ross Davis. And if you don't think that Betsy Ross was a trial to me in my youth, you have another guess. It was very difficult indeed. I was very happy to become Betsy Davis, which is what it is.
Great. How long have you been coming to Sylvan Beach?
Well, the cottage was built in 1924-25, so the record's saying. I wasn't taking notes at that stage. So we were here a few years before that when I was very small indeed. We stayed at Murray's. Well, my father was looking around. He knew a lot of people here, and he knew he wanted to live here, but he was looking around to decide where. And then the cottage, I think, took a year to put up. Ed Wilson, being the architect, it's built like all the Wilson houses. You can recognize them on sight.
Can you name a few of those for us?
Well, Milton Pillinger at the end of this row is one. It was built at the same time. It's exactly like this house, except it's way up on top of a hill. There are several. Helen McKinley's houses were built by Ed Wilson.
Okay.
Quite a few. He was a local carpenter. Wonderful old character. He had a what are those dreadful animals that get in the garbage? He kept one for a pet.
Oh, a ferret?
A bigger possum.
Possum he kept
in the house. Kept for a pet. Yes, I was terrified of it. Well, the little house on as you come down here up in Curvin, it's the first one on the second one on the right. Was where he lived.
Okay.
With the possum. Maybe it was a raccoon. I don't know. I didn't like it.
Would that be Jack Hansen's old house?
I don't think so. I never thought of it that way. Maybe.
Okay.
It's hard to remember.
Okay. Before we go too much into the history, you're also married to Brooks Davis, who has quite a history here of Sylvan Beach and is quite an historian in his own right. Could you tell us something
about him? Oh, yes, he is. He's teaching a history class right now. He's a good authority on the Civil War, but history is his main interest. We've been married almost 30 years. We had our 29th wedding anniversary. We were going on 30, and he is still utterly amazed to find himself referred to as new people.
It seems to happen a lot.
Happens a lot.
Okay, what was your first memory of Sylvan Beach and White Lake as a child?
I was thinking about that when you were talking about doing this. What it actually is taking one of those ferries. You're going to hear a lot about those ferries, and I'm not as accurate as about them as some. From Murray's Inn to way down the lake. I have no idea where we wound up, but I was enchanted with the whole trip. It might have even been the first time I'd been on the water like that. And I remember my father on it and a couple of friends of his singing on the way down the lake.
Do you remember what song, by any chance?
One of those old ones. The Bells of St. Mary's they were singing for some reason or other. I do remember.
The
they
film?
Sang that. I suppose it's from the film. It's older than the film, Joey.
Oh, is it older than the film?
Oh, yeah.
Yes,
it is. But it was beautiful. Sunshine on the water and the boat cutting along. A small boat, you know, a ferry boat.
Okay. You've certainly been involved with the Jinx for many years. Can you give us a little background on the Jinx and your history with it?
The first Jinx there that I was in, there are still pictures of around. Jeannie Murdoch is in it, Fifi, Barbara Brasher, Dot Middleton, lots of our generation is in it. It was Topsy and Eva, and there was a chorus of Topsies. And I had long yellow curls. It was an angelic looking little brat, and I was little Eva. And they were all made up, and they were wearing gunny sacks and patches and whatnot. And we sang a song called I Never Had a Mammy. And I had a dialogue in it to talk to Topsy. And it's so awful now when you hear it. Jeannie and I were talking about reviving it. We thought we would be adorable Topsy and Evas, if slightly middle-aged at the stage we were discussing it. But when we got to the dialogue, we realized that with all of the changes that had taken place during the words, you wouldn't dare recite what I had to say to the little girls, to the little Topsies.
It's somewhat of a racial problem.
Terrible. It was unbelievable, and I was, you know, memorized it, and it was trotting it off. Like I remember the one word in the song itself, which of course was charming, Topsy is singing, and the Topsies were singing, "I never had no one to tuck me in my bed, nobody gave a damn," and I said, "Topsy, darn, just where I laid my head, I never had a mammy," and so forth. It was a very cute number.
Oh, that's great. What year was that?
Darned if I know, or 20s sometime, yeah.
20.
Those pictures are dated, I'm sure. I really don't know when it was.
Well,
we all look about seven.
We all look about seven. Well, if you find the pictures, I would like to see them.
They're around. They're in everybody's collection.
Okay. Speaking of the Jinx, you're one of the many people and probably one of the most notable, if not the most notable person, to appear in our Jinxes and go on to be a great success in theater.
I don't know how notable, but it certainly was fun. Yes, I studied dancing when I was little because my mother thought every child should have a talent. They should have, if they had a talent, they should do something about it. So I kept studying, and pretty soon I got pretty good, so I got in the opera ballet. And eventually, after the Chicago Opera and the Met, then I got in Oklahoma. And I'm delighted I did because it's so famous. And then did Carousel, which is also famous.
Were you in the original productions?
In the second one. I think it was in South America when Oklahoma was first produced, but I came back and tried out for the second company and went back to Chicago with it, which was perfectly wonderful because I could live at home for a whole year and work in the theater downtown for a whole year, so it was just wonderful. Then I traveled with the show, which was great.
Carousel?
Oklahoma.
Oklahoma, okay.
Which was... great fun because it was such a huge success. The only trouble was that everybody in the show thought everything would be like that. You know, the curtain went up and everybody clapped, and the curtain came down and everybody clapped until they were told to leave the theater. It was just a great, great, great success. But everything isn't like that.
No, it's not, as we all know. What part did you play in it?
Oh, in dancing parts, you aren't often given a name, but I had a part I had one line. Dancers never talked in those days. I had one line, and I was called Armina. And that was the name of one of the ladies in the theater guild who directed these shows, Armina Marshall.
Okay, I was told that when you were on the road with that show that you made a stop in Cincinnati and partied all night one night with, I believe, the Hartses.
How'd you hear about that? Yes, we partied all night. Indeed, we did. I was delighted to take... It wasn't the Hartses. It was Jeannie and Robert Schmidt.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
Jeannie Murdoch and Robert Schmidt, who had a wonderful house there. Robert, of course, was absolutely an adorable man. And I was... I hadn't met him yet. I hadn't met Robert. And so I warned all my friends. They invited us out for a night lunch. And the following morning we were to get on the train, I think it was Saturday night or something, I don't know. Anyway, I warned all my friends that I had never met this gentleman. He was very successful. He was married to a very dear friend of mine, and I wanted everybody on their good behavior. They were darling kids, incidentally. Everybody in the show was kind of healthy and out, you know, just like the show looked. And so they were all set to be on their good behavior. And we got in to meet Robert, and he had an opera on top volume because he loved loud music and he loved to sing at the top of his lungs, and he was standing at the bottom of the stairs as they all came in singing Traviata or something like that at the top of his voice. Oh, they loved him on sight. Here's one of us, you know. So the singers sang and the dancers danced and it went on all night.
Oh,
yes, indeed.
That must have been a ball.
It was wonderful.
Can you tell me what year that was?
Oh, it was 40-something.
40-something. Was it during the war years?
Yes. We did Oklahoma during the war because we worked in all the hospitals when we were near them.
Okay. When you went to the hospitals for the veterans as you traveled with the show?
That's they weren't veterans. They were back from the wars. They were little boys, just like us.
It's a scary part of those things. Can you tell me...
The Jinx. I got my first makeup on my face during the Jinx, and Mr. Sidoni put it on. I remember very well. He used to make us up. It was probably the Topsy and Eva thing. beaded eyelashes, which was very old-fashioned now, and a beautiful makeup. He knew everything about the theater. He did the lights, did all the stage effects. You'd be amazed what they got on that little stage. When I look back at some of the things I've seen and some of the things I know happened, I can't believe they did it. They had a waterfall on it once.
I'll be darned.
I don't know how they did that.
Whose show was that? Do you remember what show was that?
But I remember Dick Tenner. Dick Tenner lived with his parents on the Michigan side, Michigan Hill, and sold their cottage a long time ago. He was supposed to slide down the thing in a barrel, which he did, and of course the barrel was a breakaway barrel and it broke, and he turned out to be in undies, long underwear.
Well, long underwear.
That was a joke. Yes.
That's great.
It was incredible.
Yeah, those were, speaking of those jinxes, how many, did you know Frank Adams? Were you in those?
Yes, I did.
Did you know something about him?
I can't tell you very much. He directed all of them. My mother would know more because he had mostly adults in the show. It wasn't until after World War II that the young people took over the jinx. At least I think that's about right. He had skits and he had wonderful music. He had very good connections in New York because he was a professional writer. And he'd done plays in New York. It was well known in New York. So he could get all the pre-published music. And the song that we sing now, Gangway for the Sylvan Beach Gang, was Mountain Greenery, which was written somewhere in the 20s. Famous old jazz tune, and he got that before it was ever popular and wrote the Wobbeningo words to it.
I'll be darned.
So it's an old one. They dropped it out of the jinx for a while, but when I was directing it with you, Joe, one year,
I think we put it back.
That's right, and everybody adores it. And it's fun now because you hear it every once in a while when old bands are playing.
That's right. And I remember when we did that jinx.
Sure.
That
darn good. Darn good, wasn't it, Joe?
Oh, those were good years.
Yeah, very good.
Some good jinxes. Of course, they're all the best. Yeah. They're all the best. You mentioned a name that's probably one of the most notable names around here. Mr. Sidoni, can you tell us something
Professor
about
Sidoni. I can't, I can't tell you much. I've just known him all my life. You know, we all knew him. He was a stunning man, probably just above height, above normal height, brown eyes, brown hair, Van Dyke. He dressed like California, open collar, white shirt, jodhpurs. Reason for the jodhpurs, they kept horses over there. I used to ride them at night up and down the beach, I remember seeing them. And he had ESP. He was a very sensitive, very far-seeing man, and he did foretell things that happened. There are people who testify to that.
Do you happen to remember any of these things?
I only remember one, and I remember it quite clearly. There again, you're going to ask me when it was. I don't know when it was. It was a long time ago.
Yeah.
But we were living in the cottage. It was sometime after 1925. Harry Pillinger was living down at that end of this row of cottages. And they must have moved out in the 30s, so it's somewhere in that area. Anyway, he's let it be known, I don't know exactly how he did it, he probably just told a few people, and you know how people talk, that in the following week, everybody should be very careful of their children, that a young person, I forgot if he said they would be drowned, they may be drowned. So be careful. So everybody fussed all week along. And a very nice young man named Lamar, who lived in Whitehall, and I think he worked for Pitkins or the Arcadia. So anyway, he was a friend of Harry's. And the two of them were fishing in Indian Bay. And I think they were in a canoe, which is foolhardy. Anyway, it tipped over and they couldn't get it back up. And Harry said, stay here. Indian Bay was fairly deserted at this point. You know, there weren't all the ring of houses or traffic, boat traffic or anything. He said, I'll swim over. So he swam across to Murray's to get help. And Lamar apparently didn't wait for him or fell off or lost hold of the canoe, and he drowned in Indian Bay. A terribly sad thing. He was a young man. He was, I think, 16, 17 in there somewhere. I think I've got the ages right. And by the time Harry got back with help, of course, he was gone. And I remember that night, the boats over looking for him and making those dreadful foghorn noises while they were doing that. It's a very It's a very sad memory.
Yes. So that was the only psychic occurrence that you were personally.
I heard about more. Mm-hmm. I heard about more, and I know he spoke to my father a lot, but I couldn't tell you exactly.
And so you felt that he genuinely was psychic.
Oh, he was. There's no doubt of it.
Do you have any other thoughts about the man? Anything that you can think of that might be of interest?
No, I think he was terribly kind to people. He had famous people over there, you know. Sophie Tucker was here once. I'm sure you'll hear more about that. And Douglas Fairbanks Jr. and Joan Crawford, when they were married, were over there. I didn't see them, but people did. And he was generally well known.
Fantastic.
Published books, and he had a bullet in a paper type thing that he sent out. My parents used to get it from him. So they were very fond of him.
Did this have a title that you can remember, this paper that he sent out?
Oh dear, I remembered it once. It's called something like the Lighthouse or the. It wasn't called Valley of the Pines. It had a beacon-like name.
Beacon name, mm-hmm. Right. Speaking of famous and notable people that came to White Lake, could you expand on that? Do you remember any other famous people or notable characters here that you've met?
Notable characters you can never stop talking about.
Wonderful characters.
But famous people, Anna Mae Wong, an old time movie star, visited Lorna Guerin. She's a beautiful Oriental girl. And I remember meeting her. Lorna brought her around. That was very charming. Elliot Roosevelt, of course, married under the beach, was therefore known as New People, and moved in with his Secret Service.
Down in the Edson.
In the Edsons, yes. He was married to Ruth Edson, and he was here for several years.
How many Secret Service men do you think he had?
I think he had two, because we used to see them, and they used to bounce around all the time in back of him. They didn't exactly bounce, they stalked.
They actually watched him all the time. Did they socialize?
I don't believe so.
What are some of the characters? I mean, you mentioned Bob Schmidt, and there are certainly a lot of characters.
Oh, Bob was wonderful. There's a clump of trees on the golf course, which he used to suck a ball into every once in a while, which is known as Schmidt's Memorial Grove, which is titled that during his lifetime, naturally. And he was just all around marvelous. Wonderful sense of humor, wonderful sense of music, very talented man, very outstanding man. His son, Doug Schmidt, you know, is a very well-known scenic designer.
Right.
Extremely successful, very well-known.
He was with the Met for a while, wasn't he?
He's been with everyone. He did opera, certainly. He did one opening night at the Lyric in Chicago, which I was proud to attend with his proud mother and the Hartzes. It was just marvelous.
Right, and he was another Jinx, came from the Jinx also.
Indeed he did. He produced it when he was a boy. He did a number called Steam Heat. And all of the holes in the stage, I believe, are due to Douglas sending steam up during the number.
I remember those holes.
You remember the holes. Did you ever see the number? I never did. I was traveling.
I might have, but I'm not sure. It's one of the things that you've heard about so many times.
Sure.
I'm not sure whether I saw it or not.
I was traveling a lot, and I missed a lot of Jinx's all in a row, for which I'm very sorry. But he also did magic tricks when he was young, which is what got him interested in the stage, and he did them in the Jinx. And it's very interesting that his stage sets, we saw his set for Samson and Delilah the opening night at the Lyric, very impressive, but nobody has ever let the temple fall down like Joseph got that, Douglas got their temple falling down. Believe me, it was just, he got a standing ovation.
and
that magic and that look, you know, of fooling the eye, really he takes into his stage sets. He's a very talented man.
Oh, his sets, I can remember, were incredible.
Oh, wonderful.
And Stevie McClave, too, was another great talent.
Yes, indeed.
He was a very good one.
Who is that lovely girl who played the guitar and sang? She was from down the beach a bit.
Cynthia Neely.
She was Cynthia Neely. It was the first one I ever heard sing Try to Remember That Day in September. She was lovely.
I remember that very well.
We have wonderful memories.
Yes.
My last favorite memory, though, was all of those beautiful girls singing Don't Cry for Me, Wabaningo. If that wasn't the greatest thing that's ever been on that stage, I thought it was wonderful.
It was incredible. It was. I was rolling myself.
Oh, I loved it.
It was excellent. What are some of the other characters that have been on Sylvan Beast that you remember?
Well, one of the most notable that, thank heaven, I met when I was very, very young when we first moved here was Aunt Min Beigler. And she lived where the McClaves lived.
Okay.
And they didn't buy the house from her. Somebody else was in between. She moved a long time ago. She was an older woman when I was a little girl. But she taught us, there were little people here along the line. Barbara Pillinger up there, myself here, Lois Wiesman, Adele, they were a little bit older. I think they knew all of this before we were. And Catherine Beigler lived with her, Jane Pillinger, in the next house. And she taught us to swim. Out here in the lake, we always swam in White Lake in the morning and Michigan in the afternoon. We must have been waterlogged by the time the summer was over. This is when we were very small, it's before we ever went down to the arcade to swim or anything like that. But she taught us to swim, and she taught us about boats, and she taught us about fungus, and she taught us where Chief Wabaningo was buried, which unfortunately is inaccurate, but we believed it at the time and enjoyed it thoroughly.
Now, where did you hear he was buried?
Oh, right back here on the road which now goes to Wisdom's. And as you go through to the lake, it's up to your left on top of that rise. That's where he's buried. Don't believe the story that happened at the other end of the lake in the White River. Not so.
What up story here. Was that?
Oh, he and his son were paddling a canoe down the White River and one of the dunes collapsed and upset the boat and eventually covered them and I guess drowned them both and covered them. And
yes,
you know, it's slid.
Haunted there in that area, isn't supposedly the ghosts?
I've only been down the White River once and I'll never do it again. I saw a snake, I did this, I did, well, forget it. So I really don't know if there are any ghosts there. I didn't stop to find out.
So the chief is buried beneath the dune.
Beneath the dune, along with his canoe, along with his son. Anyway, Etman said it was back here. She also took us out in the fall to pick bittersweet. The place was much wilder, you know. I'm talking probably late 20s. There weren't any cottages built up there at all, and there was this wonderful place called Pine Pocket, which was a big, clear sand dune with wonderful pine trees on it, and then it dropped straight down into a deeper dell, which was still sandy, and then up again. It was beautiful, quiet, dark, whatnot, close to White Lake, in the dunes right up here. And it was full of bittersweet. And it was not full. She taught us which was poison ivy. We never got it because of that. She taught us everything there was to know when you were 7, 8, 9, 6.
Just a very kind, magical person.
She was enchanting. She had a wonderful, jolly voice. You know how some people's voices seem to sing and you never forget the sound of them? She was absolutely marvelous. Her husband, Ed Beigler, was a short, round, gray, sort of, I wouldn't call it gruff. He wasn't anything like Aunt Min, though. I don't think he was that amused with children. Must have been sort of like Dennis and that man he keeps bothering. But he had a fishing canoe, pontoon canoe, rowboat with oars, and kept pulled up. See, the lake was much lower then. We had a beach.
How much more so then?
Oh, quite a lot. They had a cement runway, which he pulled a boat up on. So it was shorter over there, but the Wab Club, which was then where the post office is now, right, had a big beach in front of it. They could pull e-boats up on it and turn them over when they were caulking them in the spring. And they, ours had sand piled up, wonderful white sand piled up, and over next to it, in front of Milton Pillinger's, which Ginger now owns, was a big sandbar and a sort of a, not a sandy, wet beach there. Barbara Pillinger and I used to play suburbs on it. Our parents, my father and her father, were in the building business. Dad was in real estate. Uncle Milton was in contracting and building. So we were interested in our parents always talking about the houses that were built, the houses that were sold. So we built suburbs. We didn't build fairy castles. We built And we had homes, schools, churches, and we had a water system. All the things we heard our parents talk about, it was very entertaining. Very, very busy. And then, of course, we'd sell them to our parents.
Little lots.
Little lots, yes, little lots.
Oh, that's great. Now, speaking of the water, do you remember the water going in cycles like this? And is this the highest it's been?
Well, it's high, and it stayed high. I remember it coming up and going back only once in my lifetime, I mean right here. But this has come up, oh, I don't know how long ago, when we started putting the seawalls in, and it seems to me that all we've done now is put in more seawall. I don't think it's backed up. It might vary a little, and you might see it on the lake shore where it'd be easier to actually see. Courtney measures it every morning, so he knows it's up or down. But I haven't seen a beach in front of our place for, since the 60s, the year I was married, 1964, there was a beach because the boys came up here.
That's right.
My two boys, Scott and Dean, and we did the beach under protest.
And I used to do that every single
Sure, yeah. You all did under protest. And after that, I think it went, and I don't think I've seen a beach since.
So this is pretty radical, or pretty much of something that you haven't seen till recently, then, basically.
Sure, and it used to be fun. Oh, well, you know, the lake used to be so clear. As I said, we used to swim in it. And there was a wonderful drop-off. It would be shallow, and you'd see schools of minnows. And when it dropped off like that. I was told it was because they dredged it for the Carolina. And the boat did swing around not pretty close in your front yard, but pretty close to this, because Barbara Spear had a sailboat that used to bounce up and down like a cork when the Carolina took off and these big waves came in. But we could run, and when we were a little bit older, more than the Aunt Minnie period I'm talking about, we used to run on the little short water, you know, the little short beach, and then dive into the...
Right off the drop-off.
I pulled a little boy out of the water there once, and I got a medal for it. I was so embarrassed. This is funny.
Tell the story.
They were renting, probably, the cottage where Aunt Min lived. And he was small, and he was swimming, or was wading or something by himself. And he got into the drop-off. So I heard the help, and was on the porch, fortunately, in a bathing suit. And I tore out the front down to the thing, saw him at once. He was beneath the water, so I ran out on the sand, and so help me, leaned over. I got my head under, you know, grabbed him by his belt, I guess it was, hauled the little guy out. He'd only been there a second, and shook him off, you know, patted him out and all that kind of thing. I never got my rear end wet. You know, I didn't. I just leaned over and got him. Reed over and got him. He was in deep water. I was knee deep. I mean, the drop off was that sharp. They sent me a medal for it. I have never been more embarrassed in my life.
Now, who sent you the?
His parents arranged it. I was so embarrassed because I hadn't even gotten all wet.
It was kind of a minor, just a lift.
Absolutely. Oh, I was embarrassed. Sonny Sekel actually did save a man. He fell in. He was a big fat man, and he fell in at the dock, and he couldn't get himself out. And Sonny, who was then probably 14, something like that, and a small, slight build, not a brawny number, but certainly strong, got him out. And that was a real life-saving thing. Yes, that was something.
Now, did that happen out here?
That happened when the dock was up at the arcade.
Okay. Well, why don't we go to the arcade and to the history of that and your
Joey? I wish I could. It was the most intriguing thing. It was perfectly charming. I hated to see it go. It was a big pier. It was an L-shaped pier for the big boat to land, and it was a big boat. Caroline was big.
Can you tell us about the boat and who took it up and when it came in and just your memories of it?
Oh, I used to sit on the front. My father took it up, and he adored it up here. It was happiest time of his life when he got up here on Saturday morning. They'd get on the boat on Friday night, and they tell me they played poker all night. And then it stopped at Grand Haven. I know this because I took it home once and took it back with my father when I had to have my teeth straightened. Had to have my braces adjusted. So I rode on the Carolina. Very big deal. But at any rate, when we met the boat, you'd look up and all of the fathers would be lined up. All the men would be lined up on the boat. There weren't any women because women didn't commute. They spent the week up here. And you'd see this whole line of straw hats. And you had to pick out the straw hat under which was the loved face you were looking for.
Oh.
And then it brought cars up, too, you know. Cars were down in the hole sometimes.
Hold on, did they drop the cars off at the arcade?
Uh-huh, sure. They'd open the bottom, whatever they call it, and out would come one or two. Mostly they went to the other end in Montague.
Oh, they would
but
go
then
down there and then...
Mm-hmm. All the men would march off the boat one by one, be embraced by family, get home. My father used to sit at the head of the dining room table, have his breakfast, pick up his golf clubs, take off to the golf course, never to be seen again until later Saturday afternoon. Loved to golf. Golf course was wonderful. Then he'd come back, swim, the whole thing and whatnot.
So the men came up from Chicago and were prepared to play golf and have
anything they did, anything.
What time did the Carolina Lano leave Chicago? What time?
I can't remember it. I can remember having dinner on it. It was a lovely dining room, you know, white tablecloths, regular ship dining room, and then it would come in here at 7:30.
In the morning.
Seven. Early.
Early Saturday morning.
Really early Saturday morning. Picked them up at about 8 o'clock Sunday night. 8 or 9 it would leave. Get back to Chicago. Then, of course, they'd get off the ship and go right to work.
Boy, they certainly didn't get a lot of rest, did they, on their weekends?
They thought they did, but they didn't.
They were just playing very
hard. They played. He played hard. My father played hard, yes. They'd go to the Yacht Club dance on Saturday night. This was before I'd accomplished the Yacht Club dance. Have a cocktail party on the porch and go to the dance, all dressed up.
Can you tell me about the Yacht Club when you were growing up? Were you in the junior yacht club, or did you hang around the Yacht Club?
Yes and no. When we were very little, we didn't. And I can't remember when the Yacht Club rebirthed.
I think about 26.
Yeah, it's very dim. I certainly was in sailing school. I studied with Harry Pillinger, whom fortunately I knew very well. He scared everybody else to death. I wasn't exactly scared, but I did behave myself, and I did pass.
Now, how big of a class did you have, your sailing school?
I can't remember, Joey, because I don't remember the graduation all that well. I don't think it was all that big, or I would. We had small classes. He'd take us, some of us, on an E sometimes with two, he and another boy, and a couple of the children, but our classes were then small, you see, because we'd be on a sea a lot of times. And then there'd just be two of us. I can remember the classes in the ballroom when it was raining, when we had charted courses around the buoys, depending on which way I remember a great deal about it. But I lost my book.
Oh, your sailing school?
Yes, lost my sailing school manual. I never could find it.
Who was the best sailor during your period?
Jeannie and Fifi. They were simply marvelous. They had a sea boat. She was remembering the Wab Club one day had, one weekend had all kinds of boats in it, maybe sea boats, one after another, and people walked around and picked out the one they wanted that year because sailing just went like this, you know, when the Yacht Club started sailing races. And they used to take care of them themselves. I can remember on the beach in front of the Wab Club, the big E-boats and A-boats, the A-boats were wonderful, turned over and the men working, caulking the bottom, and then they put them in the water. They were all on buoys. They weren't on lifts. It was much more beautiful. We did look like a sailing village, I must say, a fishing village or something like that.
A lot of boats out there.
A lot of boats on buoys, but it was very pretty, much prettier, of course, than the lifts ever are, but I guess it's better for them.
Jeannie and Fifi Murdoch.
They won everything.
They
were very good, yes.
They were probably, you think, probably the best female sailors in the history of life.
They were better than a lot of the boys.
I would imagine.
Absolutely.
Knowing both of them, I would guarantee it.
Jeannie was telling me her mother, who knew nothing, and Amy Murdoch was a lovely woman, but she knew nothing about sailing at all. And Jeannie said there'd be these heavy east winds blowing, and she and Fifi would be, you know, this race was going to be really something that was coming up, you know, and their mother would say to them, have a good time, girls, have a good race. She'd be on the Michigan side with not much happening over there, you know, and they'd go and probably win it.
Yes, yes. Fifi isn't here anymore, unfortunately, but she was a real character and a splendid person. Do you have any memories of her?
She was perfectly enchanting. She was an enchanting person from the time she was young. She had one characteristic which I always thought was so loving. She never liked to see people having any trouble with each other. She liked to see things going very smoothly indeed. She liked to have everybody like each other and get along well. And as soon as there would be the slightest rift, and they occurred occasionally, Fifi would be the first one in to kind of nurse it along and fix it up. And I remember one day she had two couples on their porch, and I came in and she said, see who's here? See what I've done? They're getting along fine. That would please her very much.
Well, when I was young, she was certainly very kind to me. And a very
kindness.
Wonderful person, sweet, as you say, and just splendid. And Jeannie, too. And both.
Oh, the two of them, they have the same characteristic, and I think they got it from their mother because she was a charming, kind woman, too. She was very, very great sweetness, very great affection for everyone.
That's great.
Well, Carlisle was marvelous. Their husband had was more dominant, more feisty isn't the word, but he was a peppery number, but he was absolutely charming.
And he was married to who?
Mrs. Murdoch. This Carlisle Murdoch.
Okay.
Mr. Murdoch. Great character, wonderful. I remember one of the men on the beach was having the sand dunes on the Michigan side that were near the lake, or they were spoiling it. He had a bulldozer over there, take him down. Carlisle got out in front of the bulldozer. You shall not pass. Well, he was absolutely right. It's ecologically wrong to do it, but there he stood. He said, you can't do that, and it's definitely not in front of my house, or whatever. And he stopped, he turned around.
Do you remember who the person was?
Yes, but I'm not going
to
tell you.
Can you tell me, can you remember the worst storm? I mean, do you remember any particular night or period where the worst weather came in?
Joey, I sleep through them. I think I've been here so long, I love to see a storm come up. I rather enjoy it. I worry about the trees. The worst storm happened, I expect, when I wasn't here. It was when the Guerin's house was hit by lightning. My mother was here. It must have been a frightful night. She was wakened up, people pounding at the door, probably after midnight, and they said, leave the house. The Guerin's house is on fire and the wind is this way. Leave the house. So they did. So she did. She said, you know, what else? She said, I said a short prayer for my house and I got dressed and went out. Buster Diamond, on the other hand, who was again one of my favorite characters and who is now gone, got up on his roof with the hose, the garden hose from the front of his house, and sprayed the Jones's cottage, which is the one on the hill, Milton Pillinger's Gingers, the one on the hill, and sprayed the roof because sparks were landing on it. Rosie Jones always said he saved their house. And he did that until the fire calmed down, but the Guerin house was completely gone. It was a beautiful house.
Now, the Guerin house was on the White Lake side of
it? On the White Lake side at the top of the hill.
Okay.
It's where Marianne Johnson.
That was the Guerin house.
And it was rebuilt, you see, entirely. The Guerin house was a veranda on four sides, and it was more rustic. It was stained brown, low overhang. It was called Valhalla, and it looked like it.
It looked like it.
It was beautiful.
Do you remember what year that was approximately?
Oh, of course not.
Okay.
What was I doing, and who did I come up with? I can't remember.
Did any other cottage burn down as a result of that fire?
No.
No, that was the only
one. No, that was the only one.
Lightning hit it then, that's what they
said. That's what they said, yes.
Okay, speaking of that, do you remember the Sylvan Beach Hotel very well at all?
I don't remember it very well because I didn't live so close to it. Uh-huh. I certainly was around it a lot because when we were young, talking below 12, we used to have treasure hunts. That was our great activity, and somebody would do them and put clues. You know, you find a clue, and then you run to the other end of the beach, and you find another clue. Then you run to the other end of the beach, and so forth. And so I was in and out of the Sylvan Beach Hotel, and besides, my friends were over there. Jeannie and Fifi lived on that side. The McNabs lived on that side. So I ran back and forth a lot, so I did see it, but I'm not too familiar with it.
Do you remember any story about the Sylvan Beach Hotel or anybody famous staying there?
Not a thing.
Yeah. Did you ever, were you one of the persons that would run a telegram up for a nickel or a dime from there?
Sometimes.
Sometimes you would.
Sometimes I've done that. A phone call, you know, way back when we were little and running around like mad, we didn't all have telephones. And a telephone would come into the arcade. I forgot who got it, Mrs. Kern probably, that's Edna's mother. And whoever was handy would get the message and run up to the cottage and deliver it. Also, on Sunday, before Sunday mornings, there was always church at the Wabeningo Club. And they printed flyers announcing the church and the time. And they would be given to assorted children, and we would run all over the beach and leave one at every cottage.
Who was responsible for the Sylvan Beach Church starting up? Or?
I can't remember. It's just too far back. There was one minister that was there for a long time. Okay. This was pre-Dr. Hodson, obviously. He was there for a long time, and I associate him with his posts and whatnot. I think they knew him, or else he lived here. I don't know. That side of the beach, I only knew the houses where my friends lived, but you know, it's changed so much over there. Going over there used to be like walking through a woods. There were so many trees and so much land in front of the bluff. Mm-hmm. And it's so different now.
Well, you know, speaking of that, what do you feel? It seems like everybody's fixing their lawns and have rebuilt their cottages and things have become more official. How do you feel about that?
I don't. Our house and, we live next door to Mrs. Bratt. Mrs. Bratt was a beautiful lady. She was the first lady I ever saw with blue hair, but she was very dignified. Her house had been there a long time, and she'd been there a long time. That house had a cultivated lawn, and it had a row of pine trees around a sidewalk that went down to the lake. It was very mysterious. We couldn't see from that house to this. She wasn't mysterious. She was a perfectly charming woman, a great lady. But this house was sandy front, had juniper bushes in the front. Juniper bushes are so beautiful. They're supposed to not like people, and they go when people come. But juniper bushes and old wildflowers, Queen Anne's lace, bluebells. I miss bluebells. Bluebells are all gone. We had bluebells in the lawn. Wisman's lawn was just sort of scruffy. Aunt Min's lawn was all sand. There wasn't any lawn. It was all sandy. And people would put in, pine trees or something like that, but not much. And they had rowboats. That was the all-in, big rowboats beached, planted with nasturtiums. Mrs. Pillinger, Harry's mother, had one of those, Aunt Mabel. But then it was all sand. Now, the hill has always been, the White Lake Hill has always been, as far as my memory goes, very cultivated, all lawns. Now, I always thought it was full of old people because we used to go walking up and down and all the people would be sitting, all the Pillinger uncles and all the old people would be sitting out on there. Everybody had a lookout. And I saw it at night. It was the fashion to go walking after dinner. So I'd see it at night. No, that was always just very, very well groomed and very pretty. It still is pretty. But the Michigan side wasn't at all. They never mowed, and it was very light grass. It wasn't weedy and heavy or anything like that. It was very charming, but it was not cultivated. I had one weekend, I came up here. My father died very young, and my mother had the cottage for a long time. And she said, I can't wait for you to come up this weekend and see the cottage. And I came up that weekend, and she had a lawn put in and a bed of myrtle out in front, and that side of the house had flowers planted. I could have cried. And I didn't dare tell her because she thought it was just wonderful. So I said, oh, isn't that nice? That's just nice. and then it was all gone, and it's been lawn ever since.
I remember I felt that way when my parents rebuilt the cottage, and they didn't tell me they had done it.
Oh, it's very sad, really.
Yeah.
I think it's very smart to keep the thing that belongs there out there. I realize it can't get out of hand, and you have to have a comfortable front, but the things that grow here are so beautiful. Now, well, the bluebells are gone, the wild roses are gone. You don't see, there's another one that used to, oh, the forget-me-nots still do come in the spring, but they have to kind of fight their way through. They're on the back. They're never in the front. Nothing is so nice as I can remember one year there were forget-me-nots blooming all across the front of our house. Why, that's lovely. I think it's too bad.
I do too. speaking of that, do you find that the social aspects of Sylvan Beach, for instance, the amount of cocktail parties, things like that, have increased through the years? And is this?
I don't think so. I can remember before the yacht club dances, my parents always had people over for cocktails. I can remember Edith and Harry Sturdivant coming over for cocktails quite often. Harry would get tired. He was a little deaf. He was an adorable man. He was a little deaf, and he would get tired of the cocktail conversation, which would get louder and louder, you know, progressive the way they do. And I would be eating out here with some little guest. I was an only child, and I had a lot of my school friends up every once in a while, quite often. I was sitting out in the dining room with Nancy Seibert, my very closest friend in the whole world, and Harry would come out and talk to us for about 15 minutes, and you know, to talk to the children, and he could hear us instead of the babble outside of the party. But I think they were very social. I do recall my mother having ladies over for tea quite often. I don't see that done anymore. Mrs. Bratt had tea. Who lived next door to us, and had the ladies, you know, around here for tea. We don't do tea anymore.
Yes, no, we don't anymore. Speaking of tea and cocktails, do you remember Prohibition up here very well?
And of course not. I never saw it. No, I think they served drinks right through it.
There was never, yeah, it didn't stop anybody.
I don't recall it at all. I do remember stories about, but nothing that had to do with this place. No, I don't remember.
Can you relate a story to us?
It wouldn't have to do with Sylvan.
Oh, wouldn't?
No,
well, it's
something
okay.
else.
It's part of the history here. That's
no, it isn't.
Oh, it's not.
No, it
okay,
isn't.
Okay.
No, I, so when I said I've heard stories about it, but I didn't pay any attention to Prohibition. Didn't mean a thing to me.
Yeah, being that age, yeah, wouldn't. The biggest wedding that you can remember at Sylvan Beach.
Peg Vance. Now, isn't that marvelous? She's 90 years old now, and I can remember her wedding. I'm a little dim about it. I sat parked in the front row. Sis Seckle was the Seckles aren't here anymore. That's too bad. They were very much part of our youth. Sister and Sonny, isn't that marvelous? Sister and Sonny Seckle. I still call him Sonny. His name is Al. When I see him, which is soon. I remember sitting in the front row and watching Peg get married. It might not be the biggest, but it's the one that made the biggest impression on me. It may even have been the first one I ever saw.
Now, where was that held?
Wabeninga Club.
That's the Wabeninga Club, okay. And the minister for that was the minister that we don't, yeah, for Sylvan Beach.
Yeah, I'm very dim.
Okay.
See, it's hard to remember things that go back that far. You remember them because they're so very vivid, because they're so important to you. Your first cigarette, your first kiss, your first crush probably all happened right here, but they happened an awful long time ago.
Yes.
And so much has happened since.
Speaking about the time of history, do you remember the Depression here very well? Do you remember how it affected life on Sylvan Beach, or did it?
I think it probably did. As I have noted before, this house was not the last one built here, but almost. The houses were in place all along here, and Milton's was new, and ours was new in the 20s. 10 years later or so, the Depression, 15 years later, everybody was gone.
Except you.
Except me, my mother and myself, for different reasons. But the Depression, I think, took care of a couple of them, several. And Mrs. Bratt moved out. She was old and didn't want to keep the house. And the Wiesmans both died, unfortunately, and Lois got the cottage, so of course it was still in her in her hands. But it was pretty well cleaned out. As far as the rest of it goes, there were one or two sales. People disappeared.
So Sylvan Beach did get their share.
Oh, I'm sure of it. I'm sure of it. It was much more severe than anything we've ever known.
Yeah. So things were tight for everybody.
Mm-hmm. Everybody, I guess, all over the world. But straight across the country, and there were very few businesses that escaped the effect of it.
And back then, too, there was no safety net either.
There was no safety net, and there were therefore that many more people who were down and out.
It must have been horrible years.
It was very bad. Now, of course, all you can remember is the music.
Thank God.
Brother, can you spare a dime and buying an apple and all that kind of thing?
Now we come up to the Second World War. Can you describe what happened here during the war years?
What happened here during the war was very noticeable. There weren't any men. There were absolutely none. I can remember being much more agile in those days, being up on the roof doing something about shingles. Couldn't get anybody. All the able-bodied in Whitehall were gone. They were off. And of course, all the boys here that had sailed were in the Navy. It was a little dim. It was by the Depression. My father died in 1937, so he was just after that. But after that, we rented the cottage in August because my mother cut. Brooks is outside.
Okay, Betsy, we had a little phone call there. Could you tell us how your parents came to White Lake?
My father came when he was very young, when he was 8. He was a choir boy in the Episcopal Church in Chicago at that time. They lived in Austin. And there was a choir camp, and he came up for a couple of weeks with the boys, and they camped on a place called Murray's Flats. Now, I have no idea if what they called Murray's Flats then was Murray's Inn later or not, because I don't know the date that the hotel was built. But he came here as a boy. I never forgot it. Then he discovered, his older brother sailed up here in a yacht once out of the Chicago Yacht Club, came to White Lake, sang its praises. Then he knew Harold Pillinger, who was a friend of said older brother's, who already had a house here. He didn't have a house here at that stage. He'd have been living with his parents, probably, because my father came up to visit him before he was married. And my mother was also visiting someone, somewhere. And he proposed to her on the White Lake Hill under one of the big pine trees there. Now, if they told me where it was once, I can't remember which big pine tree it was. So I give them all a look when I go by.
That's a shame they didn't carve their name in it.
They didn't do it. They didn't do it.
Can you tell me something? What did you do as a teenager here? You woke up in the morning, you went out.
We went out the door the minute breakfast was over and rushed down to the tennis courts. And we played tennis most of the morning. Or if it was a bad morning, we got on the porch of the drugstore, of the arcade, and we played hearts. We're heavy gamblers. I don't believe we played for any money at all. The men played for money. The men played hearts, too. But we played cutthroat games of hearts and cutthroat tennis.
I see. Who were some of the best tennis players?
The tennis playing down here was perfectly marvelous. We used to watch Art Rooney. They lived in the last house on this end of the hill. He was Judge Rooney's son. Bud Runyon, Joe Runyon. And Gray and Tom Meegan from the Irish Village used to come over and play. They were very, very good players. Dick Tenner played. I'm probably leaving a lot of people out, but the men were marvelous. They were great players. The best girl player was, I'm going to say Fifi and Jeannie again. I think it was Sis Seckel. I think she beat everybody. She was a wonderful tennis player. So was Sonny. And at any rate, that was our mornings, if we weren't at the yacht club. Being younger, we went to the yacht club for swimming lessons. I left that out. We had swimming lessons from Annette Richards so we could learn properly to do the crawl and a life-saving. Swimming lessons were always with a strong east wind and a very cold day, as I remember. But teenagers, then in the afternoon, we'd go swimming in the big lake. That was still part of the program in the afternoon, over to the beach. And there was sailing in between and all of that. Okay. It was wonderful.
So you started your day at the arcade, you just kind of hung around there and played
hard. Hung out. They had slot machines, you know. We didn't play them very much. You got tired of that soon enough. And they also had punch boards where you punched and won large indigestible boxes of candy. They also had banana splits and tin roofs. All of this was partaken freely.
I see.
We never got fat. We ran around too much. We went up the old channel. We walked to Duck Lake. That was probably a little younger. Walking to Duck Lake and back. When we learned to drive, the whole picture changed.
At what age were people driving?
A little older than now, I would think. I really can't remember. I have it in mind that when you graduated from high school, you might have been given a car, so it was later.
Okay. What type of road was down here at Sylvan Beach?
I remember it being all right. I think I post-date the paving of it. You know, people talk about the road not being paved. I don't remember that.
Did the road go all?
There was a policeman, though. You knew that, didn't
yes,
you? Wonderful policeman. What was his name that I'd never forget it? He wore a policeman's hat and a policeman's uniform and a star. And he had dyed black hair, and when he perspired, it ran down. He had a place down on the beach someplace. I'm vague about him. It was a long time ago.
Joe, they called Indian Joe?
I don't think so. I think he had a real name, or else we called him a real name.
Now, where did he direct traffic?
Right in the middle of the street. the arcade was open. And then the drugstore and the post office, Rosie Specklemeyer, don't forget, on one side. The grocery store on the other side with Mr. and Mrs. Kern. Mrs. Kern was also in the drugstore. And open in the middle, a beauty shop above it where Hilder set people's hair. And through the middle was open out to the pier. The pier went straight out with these huge pilings and then over to one side, so it took the whole length of the boat, or part of the length of the boat. The tennis court was where it is now.
Okay.
With a sentry thing in the middle of it, a judge's box. And we used to sit up there and watch the tennis matches.
Was the traffic cop, was he down there right in front of the arcade then? And he just, was he hired to do this or did he just?
Sure. Oh, sure. He had a uniform and everything. He would stop the cars and let the children go back because we were forever running back and forth, of course. Generations of us ran back and forth. He stopped the cars. I've forgotten what took him out. I can't remember. Mr. Anderson was the caretaker. Now I'm going back further than teens, and he used to carry ice over his shoulder, you know, and put it in the ice box.
Right, and that ice used to
cut it out of the lake in the winter and store it in the ice house, which Kelly Sellers took over.
Sellers Barn,
yes.
The old ice house.
Yes.
Okay, now in the old arcade, was Pitkin's Drugstore in there at that time?
Sure.
Now, was there a fountain there?
Sure. Milkshakes, floats, root beer floats, chocolate sodas.
Okay.
I particularly remember the banana splits. I must have been big on but chocolate marshmallow sundaes were highly thought of, too.
As you said, you didn't gain weight. You were out.
We didn't. Heavens.
That's the best part about being young. that's wild. Did the road going into town, South Shore Drive, was that paved at that time?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It was narrow, and you could slide off easily. It was sandy gravelly at the sides. You know, it's been widened within memory, recent memory, and it's much more civilized now. It used to be not so.
Hairpin turn
was really a hairpin. There was an accident on it one day. Janie. Oh dear. She had a beautiful girlfriend visiting her, and she ran off the road going up. She didn't make the turn going up, and there's a convertible. and the car landed, Jane Bastian, the car landed on sort of on top of her girlfriend anyway, she was half underneath it. My father was the next one up the road, and he, by that time, another car around, and he and another man got down there and got car up off the little girl. Not a little girl, they were teens driving the car, naturally. They were older teens, and she was all right afterwards, not all that badly hurt, and could have been. Janie was all right. And I remember Janie climbing up the side as we were there so quickly and being just hysterical over this terrible thing, go get her, go get her. But at any rate, when the other girl came to, she said, I remember the best looking man helping me out, and it was my father. It made his day, made his month, made his year.
A real hero and handsome too. That's great. Now, did Jane who, or Janie who?
That was Jane Bastian.
Okay, now the lady driving the car, the person driving the car was Jane Bastian.
Yes, it was her car.
Okay.
They lived down, they lived where, Bastian's house. It's where Mary, Terry Berry, Mary Louis.
Byam.
Yeah, Georgia. It's where they live now.
Speaking of Janes, we were talking and we hadn't mentioned Jane Pelton. Can you tell us about Jane Pelton?
Oh, she was a wonderful woman. She was absolutely marvelous. She was from St. Louis, tall, handsome, dark-haired, dark eyes, very spare. She was kind of like a quieter, more dignified Hepburn type. And there's a young picture of her in some of the old books that looks like Jackie Kennedy. Obviously a beautiful girl. She was smart, and when she was young, she became an architect. Now, when Jane was young, she died in her 90s just last year when there weren't any women architects. So she was a woman architect. She worked in an architect's office. But when the Depression came, her parents told her that she really shouldn't be working because she was taking a job away from a man. They could afford not to work, I suppose this was part of the logic, but it was too bad because she never did go on with her career, but she was an excellent artist. We have one of her sketches at home of birches that were on the well-remembered curve on the way to Whitehall. She sketched them, and we have that now at home and treasure it, of course. She was an ardent canoeist and an ardent golfer. She used to go to the golf course at about 7:30 in the morning and play around by herself. Of course, it was wet, it was full of dew, half dark. They did a sketch in the Jinx about her one year with the lantern, and you know, four teeing off and picking up the lantern and going down the first hole. She was a wonderful sport. She was also in the Jinx sketch, the famous sketch where Jeannie was Cleopatra. And John Holloway was Mark Anthony, I expect, and Jane was the Egyptian servant, probably bought the ass for Cleopatra. But she was ardent canoeist, as I mentioned, just loved nothing better. And to through her 80s, you go out in a canoe with her. She was just excellent. She took wonderful trips. She took a trip to China before anybody ever heard of doing it. And she was alone on quite a lot of it. She had
what year would that be?
That she went to China? In the 20s.
29.
And she also took a trip to Mexico with one of the Middletons. Traveling wasn't that simple. That sounds now everybody goes to Acapulco, but traveling around Mexico and sketching the ruins and whatnot, that was a different world. And China must have been absolutely incredible. She went back much to China, much later with Mary Stuart, who was her goddaughter. And she said, at that point, China was much more regulated. You couldn't do this and you couldn't do that, but they had this lovely trip together. And Jane would look at something and think, I could tell them what's around that wall. I could tell them what, but you can't see it any longer, you know. So her, her trip to China, around Asia alone, I think she met her family in Honolulu. But she traveled all down that area. And she was all around the most enchanting companion. She used to have us over once a year, a little crowd over for, Jane went to all of the parties. cocktail parties, but didn't drink. I think she sipped something rather. But she had this concoction she made of Southern Comfort. It was enough to kill you. But she would proudly mix it up every year for after church and before brunch, before brunch at Murray's. It was a stiff drink.
Oh.
And a very stiff morning. But she was a great beauty and a great friend to everyone on the beach.
Well, she certainly
lovely
was.
Lady.
She was only,
lovely
I can
lady.
I remember kindness from her.
She's a great memory.
Very considerate person, very wonderful person, a great loss to us.
Wonderful background. She was a remarkable woman, way before her time.
Yeah, right. I
mean, way before.
In the 20s.
Mm-hmm.
That's incredible. As you say, in Mexico, the roads, I'm sure they didn't have roads.
Oh, no.
Roads
probably went by horseback or something. Donkey.
That's, yeah. She will be sorely missed. During the time that you were doing theater, I just wanted to ask you, you did Carousel, which, of course, is just an incredible show in Oklahoma. Did you ever meet Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammond?
Yes.
What can you tell us about that?
Oh, well, they were lovely. Wonderful men, and they both had beautiful wives. They used to visit the show quite often. They were crazy about Oklahoma, particularly Mr. Rodgers. I think just before that, everybody that was connected with the Theater Guild, it had rather a rocky several years, and Oklahoma, of course, just blew up. It was wonderful. Rodgers was crazy about it. He used to stand in the wings and watch the whole show. You'd think he would have gotten tired of it. And he also used to love to rehearse it. Now, he didn't have to rehearse it because it had a director, it had a stage manager, and it had an overall director of their musicals who rehearsed it, and it had Ruben Mamoulian, the director, who came out twice a year and also rehearsed it. But Richard Rodgers used to rehearse the show just because he liked to see it. And we never minded because we liked Mr. Rodgers. So we'd trot through the whole show for Mr. Rodgers.
So he's very kind.
He was very sweet. We were all kind of in awe of both
sure.
of them. Mr. Hammerstein looked like a European prince. He was tall and dignified and gray-haired. And very courtly, very, very nice. He wasn't nearly as cozy. Mr. Rodgers looked like a little brown chipmunk. And he's a little friendly man. We didn't talk to him very much, but I did talk to him one night. We went out the stage door at the same time. And he knew most of us. He'd seen us several times. He was apparently good at names. So he said hello, and I said hello, and I said, "Tell me, Mr. Rodgers, I've always wanted to know, out of all of the things you've written, and I've heard all of them by this time, which is your favorite? Do you have one?" Now, this is Oklahoma. This is before Carousel. It's before Sound of Music. It's before King and I. It's before all of that. And he said, "Yes, it's a funny little song." He said, "I like it the best of anything I ever wrote," and he said, "Nobody else ever cared as much for it as I did. It's a song called You Are Too Beautiful." And have you ever heard it?
No.
Oh, it's charming. Well, fortunately, I knew it. I had heard it. It was in an old movie that was not very popular, of Al Jolson's, who sang it. Never became a very popular number, but Richard Rodgers had written it, and he liked it the best. And I always wished I'd seen him later, you know, afterwards, that he did so many wonderful things and said, "Now which do you like?"
Yeah, really.
Which
really.
Do you like?
Carousel, which is my favorite, music-wise, what part did you play in that? What role or what?
I had nice parts. Carousel wasn't much for dancers. It was more modern. And it was like Oklahoma. We did talk in it and acted in the, you know, little scenes and ran around, demoted, and carried on. I did finally the Queen of the Carousel, which is not much different from the other ones, and from the other carousel people, except you get lifted higher. And
the ballet?
The June dance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, June.
Yeah, there's a June girl in there who does, and all that was Agnes's extremely repetitive choreography, and you do everything about four bars ahead of everybody else, and that was that there. I didn't like Carousel.
Oh, you did? No.
I love the show. I think it's fine to watch, but it was not so much fun to be in. In the first place, it's terribly sad.
Yeah.
And if we stand on stage during the last scene in your girl graduate costumes, you know, with your hair and a big bow and all that kind of thing, if you turn around and watch a scene, you're bound to cry. It is just so sad when he comes back and tries to speak to his daughter and all that thing, and then she lights up because she knows
there.
Feels, yes. And So we always stared blankly at the audience and didn't look around. I used to go
so
up.
You were really moved each time you.
Oh yes, sure. It's a sad scene.
When you walk through a storm, that song is.
That's
sad.
Right, and sure, and you hear that over and over again, and that's very trying, and it always reminds you of all the sad things in your life, and you. Also, Carousel was hard on dancers because there was a hard dance at the beginning, which was the June number, that had falls in it, you know, back to the floor and all that. And, so you had to warm up entirely for that. Then there was a long, long spell where you didn't do anything except the hornpipe, which was nothing but skipping around and looking cute. And then you'd have to do the carousel waltz, which is again very difficult, and had some more falls in it. So you'd have to warm up all over again. Very trying.
What was your favorite song in that show, Carousel?
Yeah. Oh, Julie Jordan, the park bench scene. I used to go up and watch that whenever I felt like I needed a change from the dressing room or whatnot. The song where they sit on the park bench and they fall in love with each other. And he says, "You're a queer one, Julie Jordan. You are." You know
that's
that?
My favorite song.
Yeah.
Yes, that's my favorite one.
It's wonderful.
It is. It's still moving.
And then it's "If I Loved You." That's. Yeah, but there's this whole build up to "If I Loved You."
That's my favorite. That's funny. That's my.
And the other one is Mr. Snow, of course.
Mr. Snow. Yeah, it's excellent. But "If I Loved You," yes, I love.
No, it's enchanting.
It is. There's something magical.
But Oklahoma was always fun. We had John Raitt, you know, and he was so adorable. They were training him for Billy Bigelow.
Yeah.
So they found him in California and put him into Curly's part in Oklahoma, and he was wonderful. But he was a klutz. He was a big man, you know, and it's absolute klutz. A lot of singers can't keep time to music. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
Well, they can't. They learn something different. They don't learn rhythm. And not, you know, classical singers. And there was one scene, the opening, the farmer and the cowman should be friends, you know, the grand right and left. And he was right opposite me in that. But so that halfway around the circle, I'd get John's right hand. By that time, he had his left hand out and his left foot. He could not make it, and he never did. But he was an adorable man, and so
very
talented.
Very nice man.
Charmer. Sweet, open-hearted, warm, very nice.
Next question just off the cuff. What was the best performer you ever met? The kind, decent, down-to-earth, helpful, but famous still. Is there anybody in particular that's an outstandingly gracious?
Helen Hayes.
Helen Hayes was.
She's the most gracious woman that ever lived, I think.
Now, where did
they're all nice. Invariably, the bigger they are, the nicer they are.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. I met Ethel Barrymore, which was a thrill of a lifetime, and she was perfectly charming.
Now, how did you meet these two?
I met Helen Hayes when I was very young. She was doing Mary of Scotland in Chicago, and I was taken backstage. My father knew people, and I met a lot of people. And then I kept meeting her, and the last time I met her was Brooks. We were at a benefit, and she was the honoree of the benefit, staying in Chicago with a friend of ours.
Oh, wonderful.
So I met her periodically over a period of years. I only met Ethel Barrymore once. The comedian in Oklahoma took me to meet her, and they spent the whole time. She was in her dressing room after the show. She never left her dressing room. She was an older woman then. And she had her glass of bourbon on the dressing table. She was having her little nip before they brought her dinner in for her. And they were comparing voices. They had the funniest conversation. She had a very low, throaty voice, and he had a very low voice. And they both kept saying, "darling," to each other. You know, everybody said, "darling," in the theater. And then they said Tallulah Bankhead was one in the lineup that also had the same kind of a voice. And the one before that, I think they called up Mrs. Siddons or someone, some old English actress who had exactly the same kind of a voice. And they went on about that. It was interesting to hear them talk. She was adorable.
Oh, that is fantastic. What male actors did you like that you met or worked with that are very famous that were halfway decent?
They were all halfway decent. They were very, very nice. There are very few people that are big stars that are really rotten. And I remember I was in two musicals that were the healthiest musicals that have ever been put on the stage. And they hired people who looked like the girl next door, who looked like the boy. You know, they. So we didn't get any glamorous characters. We really didn't. We got the healthy types, but they were
Chart. We got a workout, too.
We got a workout, too, yeah, but they were perfectly charming people. I was thinking of the opera, probably the nicest person there was a big German tenor called Kurt Baum. Ezio Pinza was a big wolf.
Oh, really?
Yes, he really was. When he was younger, I guess he turned out all right. But of the opera stars, Kiapura also. Yeah, some, they weren't all, they, it was not all roses.
There were some weeds,
a few weeds.
In that carousel, just another question off the cuff. I was just read recently that when they did the film score, that they used a 110 piece symphony to do the film score. Now, was the orchestra that played for the show, was that bigger than normal?
Yeah.
Oh, was bigger.
But it's still a pit in a pit.
It's still a pit in the
orchestra pit. Yes, it wasn't anywhere near that big. But it was more. It had more symphonic instruments in it that would normally be put. They changed the orchestrations. You know, there's a very fine man in New York who did the orchestrations for both of those shows. And they call for different instruments. And Carousel had probably more strings in it than Oklahoma did.
Yeah,
the songs. They were more lyric.
How about Al Jolson? Did you ever meet Al Jolson personally?
No, my father knew him. He went to races with him because Al Jolson played in Chicago at that time.
What did your father do that he knew all?
He was in insurance, and he did some insurance work for the Schubert Midwestern. The Schuberts had an Eastern section, a Midwestern section, and they owned theaters all over. And the head of the Midwestern section was a good friend of my father's. His name was Sam Gerson. He's probably the kindest man I met in the show business. He was an adorable man. And he loved my father. They were very, very good friends. And he introduced him to Jolson. They went to the races together several days. Not together, in a group. And he said everybody called him Jolie, but I called him Mr. Jolson. He also said, I think I either did see him once or he talked about it so often. He wore a white cap and a white polo coat. I think I saw him. I don't really
remember.
Was he
a very decent man together?
I guess he was darling.
Oh, yeah.
The one I always wanted to meet was Bing Crosby, but I only talked to him on the telephone once.
How did you happen to talk to him?
We were at a party after the theater in San Francisco, and we were going to Los Angeles. And one of the men there was named Bill Dahl, the theatrical agent for Crosby, I think, at that time. And we were talking, they were teasing us about what we would do, and, you know, about what we would do when we got to Hollywood. Who would we see? So we pulled him out, and I said, the only one I want to meet is Bing Crosby. And they said, Bing Crosby? You know, because he wasn't a glamorous type. I just adored Bing Crosby. I said, yes, I'd like to meet Bing Crosby. And he said, well, I can arrange it. I said, I'll call him up. I'll call him up right now, and I'll put you on the phone. And he did.
What did you talk about?
I don't know. I was paralyzed.
Starstruck.
Then. Absolutely. But when that voice came over the phone, we sounded just like Bing Crosby. I was absolutely young.
Did you meet Bob Hope ever?
Well, I never met Crosby because he was making a show that took him out of town just at the time when we were making, you know, connections with people and all that kind of thing. It was in the mountains. It was a show about the Alps, whatever it was. And he was out in the Rockies filming, so I never met him.
What are some of the other personalities you met during your theater years and after even?
Well, the spell in Hollywood was the most fun because we did meet a lot of people. This man who introduced me to Ethel Barrymore took me to a theater party one night, a real theater party. It was at the house of one of the big agents. We were amazed to find out that the agents are the most important people in Hollywood. They have big houses and big yard, big estates and big things and big parties. So it was a dinner party. And of course, we got out of the theater at 11:10, put on formal and black tie very quickly, and sped to wherever they were, Beverly Hills. And got there, they'd had a long, long, long dinner, and they were just milling around after dinner, and the entertainment was about to begin. And what they did there at that time was entertain each other. The singers would sing, the musicians would play, and so forth and so on. So that night we met a host. We met Nanette Fabre. The hostess of the party's name was Benevenuta. You might not remember that name. She was a singer. Well, she'd married this agent. She was a stunning-looking woman. Constance Moore was there, too. Davy knew them very well. He'd been in a show with them. So he started talking, and I started wandering around. And of course, I didn't know a soul, and all of these familiar faces flashing by. But I did meet a columnist from Chicago. Well, Davy was talking to his old friends, who introduced me to everybody. Danny Kaye was there, who was darling, and he sang, and his wife was there, who wrote a lot of his material. I forget her name right now. Rita Hayworth was there, who was gorgeous, looked like a little princess. She was just enchanting looking. Lana Turner was there. Tony Martin was there. Oh, more. It was very nice. So how do you do to everybody? I thought Lana Turner was the most beautiful woman I've ever seen in my life. She was just enchanting, very tiny.
Now, how many years did you spend out there?
Only 6 months.
Only 6 months.
Mm-hmm. That's long enough to meet everybody.
Yeah, long enough, maybe. That's fascinating, Betsy. And I recently, you told me, too, that you knew the Kennedys, or part of the Kennedy family.
One of the Kennedys. Kennedy. Well, that's very recent. He's another generation. He lived in our apartment building in Chicago.
That's fascinating.
And Brooks, of course, knew him very well because...
Didn't Brooks get him into the apartment building?
No, he arrived there, but that's, I told you, we were asked to give one of them at the Mart said
to be
very, very nice if you gave a party. So we said, well, all right, we'll get the young people in the building. Well, Christopher Kennedy, of course, is very young and very rich. And there weren't anybody else that young in the whole apartment building. So we kept backing it off for a while and thinking we should do this. Well, finally, one day we were just having one, and we had a whole big mixture of people there, and we invited Christopher and his adorable wife to come. And they did. And he was a social success. He's charming to everybody, perfectly darling. He looks like both his father and his mother, and it's unmistakable Kennedy. Unmistakable.
That's fascinating. Kind of back to Sylvan Beach now. The maids that used to work up here, do you have any memory of the maids that used to work here?
Not too many. The people on the White Lake Hill and the Michigan Hill always seem to have colored maids, Afro-American that is. And they, the thing I remember most, I remember one or two of them very vividly, but there are other people I'm sure who could remember them more so. The thing I remember about them was when the boat pulled out on Sunday evenings, they'd all go down, a lot of them would go down to the beach, and there were many, would go down to the beach, and there was a big stack of lumber there, for what reason, I don't know, but it was stacked up like tiers, and they'd sit on them and sing while the boat went out, and it was perfectly charming.
Do you remember songs they sang?
Absolutely not. I was probably crying because my father was leaving. I burst into tears every Sunday night.
Now, I suppose you did. I've heard this several times. You probably ran over to the Lake Michigan side then.
To look at the boat. You could see the boat way out in the, and you could hear the toot when it came out of the channel. You could also do that in the morning and see it come in.
Now, did your father have, I've heard that many fathers had signals that they would use their straw hats or boaters, they'd make a signal through the porthole.
My father had an individual whistle, and I cannot do it, but it was unmistakable, and I haven't thought of that for years. I've never heard the like of it since, but we could always hear the whistle, and it was so piercing and so loud that you could hear it from there, if you were on the shore, but you could definitely hear it when the boat got anywhere near.
I'll be done.
It was fun.
That's incredible. Another person that was kind of a character here, and I think he lived next door in our place, was the man who used to blow the trumpet out in White Lake.
He was adorable. There was Doc Foster. Well, there were two, you know. People have heard, oh yes, when I was very young, it was Doc Foster. And he was, I believe, in the band. The band used to live at the Wabeningo Club, you know. They had a 5-piece band and they lived in the club. They were all college boys, and they played on the Wednesday night dances at the Wab Club. There were dances at Wab Club on Wednesday night, over here on Saturday night. And before that, the bands may have played more. I don't know. But I do remember the Wednesday night dances, and I remember the band boys being there. They were all very nice. They were from college, earning their way through. And he was I think he was there, and he was a trumpet player. Well, he dated and later married Adele Wiesman, who was the most beautiful girl. There are old pictures of hers in the Jinx. Big blue eyes, soft blonde hair, lovely. Oh, she was enchanting. And I think they eloped. And he was the first one who went out in the boats and played the same instrument. And lo and behold, Adele died very young and very suddenly, early in their marriage. And then we never saw him again. But I have a follow-up to that. It's fun. The next one, of course, was John Reitz, who married Lois. And I think they eloped. He's also a trumpet player. And he did it at length, and he's the one that everybody now remembers because he did it so often, and he was wonderful. He'd go out there and play these marvelous songs, and of course that, you've heard it, haven't you? Sure, sure. Oh, it was lovely.
Magical.
When he came back, Harry took us out on a boat, and John played again, but that was, you know, several years ago. They live in Florida now.
Yeah, he used to play in a band in Florida, too, I believe.
Well, when I was in Oklahoma, in Los Angeles. One night, the doorman brought a note back for me, which said, when I lived on White Lake, and then he gave whatever dates it was early 30s, late 20s, I don't know when Doc was here, but it was a long time ago. We lived next to a little girl next door whose name was Betsy Ross, who said she was going to be a dancer. Are you possibly that girl? And Doc Foster. Can you believe?
Oh, my golly.
Oh, it was enchanting. We had the most marvelous reunion.
Must have stopped you.
I hadn't seen him for years, and there he was.
Recognized your name? Wow.
Recognized the name. Little girl who used to say she would be a dancer. Are you that one? Yes, indeed, I am. Oh, it was great.
Just an aside, I was talking to a man by the name of Ed Reitz, who used to be with the Reitz. He was a member of their family. And I can't remember how the name was changed from Reed to Reitz. But anyhow, he stayed in that cottage.
He did.
With the family. And Robert Reed, who was the lead in the Partridge Family,
oh,
his cousin, and he would stay in that
oh,
cottage.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
So I just found that out, and I never knew that. You know, I just thought, I didn't know if you heard that or knew that, but it was kind of fascinating, you know, to run into this fellow. He was telling me all about that.
All about that. Well, John Getz, you know, has been a big star from Michelinda.
Right, John Getz is another
big star on the New York stage and in the movies.
Right.
Very successful man.
Very well. Very kind man, too. Let's see. Oh, when you would go to town in the 20s and that, or when you wanted food or something and you wanted to shop, what did you generally do?
We could buy a lot of things at the arcade. We had a grocery store.
Right.
But we went to, what did we go to in town? Edna and Leonard had a grocery store after they closed the one here, but that was later. I don't know what we did in Whitehall.
How often did you go, do you think? As often as you do now?
Once a week.
Once a week there was no need to paradise.
What I remember even better than the shopping in town, which I probably paid no attention to, was coming back down the shortcut. We used to call the Michelinda Road the shortcut because it was shorter than going on the other drive, the scenic, and it was shorter to out to 31 than to Muskegon. We'd come down the shortcut, and on the left-hand side of the road coming back was a house and a flower garden run by the Shepmans. It's an old name over there. You know where you come down Michelinda Road and all of a sudden the trees close over the top. There's a whole section.
Yeah.
Well, it was just after that. The sun came pouring down on their little yard, their biggest yard, I guess it was, and all the women would buy bouquets for the weekend when the men came up.
That's great.
I particularly remember the California poppies she raised.
And so when the men arrived here, they would receive flowers?
No, they'd be in the house. The house, yes, everything would be done up. That was the high point of the week, Saturday and Sunday.
What year was the arcade taken down? Do you have approximately?
I don't know. It was when I wasn't here. I would have stopped it. late 30s, early 40s, sometime during the war, maybe. Those years get a little vague for me because I was working, and I was, after my father died, as I said, we weren't here all summer long, and he died in 1937. And yes, he was very young.
Speaking of the war years, the Second World War years, of course there were, how did that affect Sylvan Beach? Do you remember anything in particular? Was it harder to get here? Was there
gasoline?
Gasoline,
worry about having enough meat. We had to have coupons for meat. I had a good friend at home who was whose father was a butcher. Fixed us up fine. We brought a ham up here. The beginning of the season, we ate ham. Oh, for a long time. I remember that very well.
A lot of rationing.
A lot of rationing, but of course so many things are grown around here that I don't think we really suffered much. Except that the labor, the men were gone.
Yeah, again.
You know, something broke, go fix it.
Yeah.
As I say, I turned up on the roof myself with directions from beneath, and there were all kinds of things like that.
16 million men gone. It makes.
They were wiped out around here. In a small town, you notice it. And everybody, all the boys here, of course, my age, were gone.
Were there any people from Sylvan Beach who were killed in the Second World War?
No. Joe Runyon was killed afterwards in the Air Corps, but not during the war. He was a lieutenant commander of the Air Corps in World War II, and he was in the Air Corps after that, and he was killed in an accident on a flight.
So we had no, thank
but
God.
No casual, I don't think there are any casualties in the war.
That's good. During your teenage years, you spent most of your time down here on Sylvan Beach, basically, except when you went to the yacht club.
We didn't wander around very much.
Did you drink then? Was there drinking among the younger people? There were drugs, anything? Do you remember?
Oh, no drugs. We hadn't heard of it. Except professional musicians was the only time you ever heard of drugs during that era. You didn't hear about it otherwise. But drinking you did. Yes, there was, but we couldn't get anything but beer, if you recall, until I don't know when. But in my case, I stayed remarkably sober because I couldn't stand beer. I was the world's cheapest date because I could drink one, you'd get it by the bottle. By the time it got to the end, it was lukewarm and perfectly dreadful. And I couldn't swallow any more than that during an evening. So there wasn't much drinking. Beer at the yacht club, I think, of course. The older boys drank, I think they made more talk than they drank, but some of them probably drank a lot. But not hard liquor, I don't remember, except with the parents' cocktail parties. We got around to it later, naturally.
Yeah.
But teenagers, no. I don't think so.
You know, we rarely did as teenagers, maybe twice a summer. Mm-hmm.
Peach brandy at a beach party one night, and I got sick behind a sand dune. You didn't know that, did you? I tell a few people.
Well, now you've told just a few more.
Yes.
What do you remember? Do you remember it? Of course, it's probably before you.
Jeannie Murdoch held my head. She came and helped me because I was sick.
Oh, jeez.
I've been devoted to her ever since.
When somebody does that to you, I have a friend that way too. I was so miserable.
Yes. I haven't thought of that for years either, thank heaven.
Do you remember the Reverend Dowie at all?
No, before my time. Of course, you always hear the legends that he had a net spread under the water and he walked on the water and whatnot. And that the choir was on the tiered, in white robes, were on the tiered hills over there. And that he lived just north of Chicago. I think he had his settlement over there in one of the small towns, a very religious town. And came up here in the summer.
Zion, Illinois,
exactly.
Yeah, I remember just right there.
El Pac was famous. He was a very big what was he, a big what? He was a big millionaire or something like that. I don't know what he got a millionaire at or how he did it, but he was. He had a huge boat. It was bigger than a power boat and smaller than a yacht, but he used to go like a bat up and down the lake.
Yeah, I remember, I think my grandfather went in business with him.
Did he?
One year for speedboat races up on the lake.
Oh, yes, yes, he was involved in that. I remember that dimly,
yeah, that
very
was a
dimly.
Flop because everybody just went to the other side of the lake and didn't buy tickets, I guess.
Nobody liked the stink boats. We liked the lake quieter.
Did you? Yes.
Very annoyed with the motorboats.
So the teenage boys didn't have, like we grew up with, each one with a powerboat or things like that. You didn't have, that's just not...
Sailboats.
Sailboats was your...
They had a sail, yeah, that was sailboats. That was every once in a while our mode of transportation or dating.
Were by sailboats.
Mm-hmm.
They
had cars, the boys here drove fairly young.
And I gather Bill Getz used to come over here quite a lot.
Sure, he was the first foreigner we saw. A darling man. He drove a great, big, enormous touring car of some sort. Marvelous boy. Dated Dot Middleton.
Oh, okay.
Didn't you know that?
No, I didn't. Do you remember Jack DeFranco?
Yes.
Can you tell me some stories about him, just about?
No, I can't. He was a perfectly darling man. He used to love to take Fifi Murdoch out when she would go. She was very popular. And he lived with the Sidonis, sailed a great deal. It was very charming, and I know very little about him.
But he was the one who did all those maps that we see.
Yes, sure.
Very talented.
Yes. We have ours right out there.
Oh, God, I have to look at that.
Everybody does, yeah.
That's really, I think, Betsy, about all I have. If there's something you think of or that we need to add to or anything like that, just let me know and we'll do it.
I'll probably think of everything right after you walk out the door. Think of more of it. I think when you think of the lake, you think mostly of the people. And you can see them in different places, you know, on the Michigan shore.
And that's probably the most important part of the...
Yeah, Club Dock, all over.
Yeah.
It's the most important part.
Was the junior yacht club very active, or were you active in the junior yacht club?
It wasn't as well organized as it became later.
Okay.
We were simply there. We were over there a lot, certainly, at the sailors' lunches and watching the races or in the races or just generally around. We certainly populated the Saturday night dance. That was a big event.
And that you would go by car?
Mm-hmm, by car.
Okay, and back to the maids, there was one thing, an incident that occurred on the Lake Michigan side in front of the now-present book cottage. And I wondered if you could add anything to it where a maid was drying her hair at the stove and her hair caught fire.
I don't know the story.
Yeah, Peg Dilly told me this, and I'd heard it when I was a child. That her hair caught fire and she ran out the front door, headed toward the lake, and they tried to put the fire out, but she died anyhow.
Good Lord, I don't know that.
Yeah, that's, I heard that as I said when I was
a child. Yeah, I wonder who's,
came up with that again too.
How a dreadful, dreadful thing.
Yeah, she was a white maid, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It was horrible. Well, Betsy, thank you very much.
Thank you, darling.
It's been one of the most notable people we have here.
I doubt that.
Oh, I know.
I doubt that, but it's certainly been fun, every bit of it.
Well, thank you very much, and it's been a pleasure.